right there. You're right. Man. Don't even you do this to me. Now I gotta regroup. Yeah. You figured right. Okay. I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God. I pledge allegiance to the local church and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one Savior, crucified, risen, and coming again with life and liberty to all who believe. I pledge allegiance to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your mercy and grace. Thank you for getting Virgil home safely. Pray to be with Trixie as she's recovering from that heart catheterization and that, Father. And, God, we pray that you be with Mrs. Maddox and that you keep her comforted and be with our church family wherever they are, wherever they're not here. And we give you all the praise and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Maybe seated. All righty. Well, we're doing a study on angels, the angel of the Lord. And we did it by book. And we're in Matthew now, the angel of the Lord in Matthew. There are three mentions, two of which involve dreams of Joseph. Joseph is the fourth person after Manoah's wife, Elijah, and Zechariah to have more than one encounter with the angel of the Lord. So, Matthew chapter 1. While he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared on him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. Then Joseph, being raised from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him his wife, and knew her not, till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Whenever you go over that stuff, you should also note that Jesus was virgin born, but after that, it was on, right? Marriage had brothers and sisters, amen. So it's not like the Catholic Church, Immaculate Conception, and, you know, including her emancipation, including her resurrecting, in case you didn't know the Catholic belief. They believe she didn't die. Yeah, she ascended, because after all, she's the mother of us all. Yeah, so I know it's weird. Okay, Matthew chapter 2, talking about the angel of the Lord. Matthew chapter 2, let's see, verses 13 to 15. And when they were departed, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream, saying, arise, and take the young child and his mother, and flee into Egypt, and be thou there until I bring thee word, for Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. When he arose, he took the young child and his mother by night, and departed unto Egypt, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. So, then we have a last reference to the angel of the Lord in Matthew, and that took place after the resurrection, after the resurrection. And so, Matthew 28. Matthew 28, 8 and verse 2. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. So the angel removed the stone. Amen. Verse 6. Somebody talked to him too, right? He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay. And we know that that's the angel talking there. Amen. What are you learning? You're learning about angels. Angel of the Lord is the theme of Vance's book. And in a lot of instances, we see that could be the Lord Jesus Christ is the angel of the Lord, captain of our salvation in a lot of places. We have the angel Lord in Luke, and that's Luke 2, 9 through 12. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. The time I get there, I think about Christmas with the family, and I think about how the Messiah. You know, a lot of verses, even in the Psalms, it's hard not to hear them singing in that choir once your little brain washed. Yeah, good to see you, buddy. Amen. Okay, the angel of the Lord is in the book of Acts. There's four accounts, and two of them are prison breaks. Amen. We like that. Acts chapter 5. Chapter 5, let's see, verses 19 and 20. But the angel Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, Go, stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. Wow, what was going on to them? A little testimony there. Now remember, they're sitting there minding their own business in a deep, dark dungeon, and the angel comes, wakes them up, so let's go, right? Sort of neat. And then also in Acts chapter 12, verse 7. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, Arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hands. That's a good verse, isn't it? I like that word smote. I guess, you know, it's like smack. It wasn't just like, get up, Peter. So he probably jumped up and then saw that angel and listened to him, apparently, because I believe that's the account where he knocks on the door where they were praying for him. Remember that? And everybody was in shock, like Baptists are when we get an answer to prayer. You know, the girl comes to the door, she runs back and says, Peter, and they say, yeah, right. You know, right. He's in prison, right? Peter was probably in shock waking up in the middle, and after that day, he's waking up in the middle of the city. I mean, where to go? Looking around, saying, ain't nobody here. I'm not in jail. So he ran to their house. So imagine they had a good conversation. That was 12 and 7. Then we have Acts chapter 8. In verse 26, and the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, saying, Arise, and go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. We know that this is going to be the account where Philip the evangelist hooks up with the Ethiopian eunuch, and that eunuch, being a black man, is saved, like we're saved today, by belief, because remember he was on the chariot, riding from Jerusalem. He was a Jewish proselyte coming from Passover, and Philip ran with him apparently for a while before he jumped up and he says, "What did he say?" He says, "What thou readest?" And he was reading Isaiah 53. He says, just paraphrased, "I can't understand it except some man show me." And Philip hooked up with him and showed him who Jesus Christ was in Isaiah 53. And right away, immediately, being a proselyte, remember, they cleansed themselves from baptism. Remember John the Baptist when he was baptizing? Under Old Testament circumstances, he says, you had to have fruit. You had to have meat of repentance. In other words, there had to be some proof of your repentance. Then you come to him and you get baptized, cleaned in water. Church of Christ believes that. Catholic Church believes you can get rid of original sin when you're a baby, and you take care of that. That's why godparents are there, right? But something to think about, all these different religions, and you never succumbed to that. You never were tricked into that, like millions were. And all you did was understood that you were a sinner, and you believe Lord Jesus Christ, death, burial, resurrection, did that all for you, and you asked the Lord to come in. You believed what he did, and you got saved. No water. Water came afterwards. Afterwards. The Bible says it's a figure. It's a sign of what? Death, burial, resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. When you got baptized, if it's a Baptist church, you go underneath the water, which is representative of his death and burial, and you're raised to newness of life, according to Romans, I think, 6. And most of us do that way. And we do the three, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, not just Jesus. Even though Jesus incorporates all three, the Lord, we use all three. Why? That's just what the guy end of the gospel said, and we just do it. That's all. But baptism does not save you. And that's why when the eunuch, if you read chapter 8 there, he says, "See, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized?" He read the Savior, Isaiah 53. Okay, what's the deal? Here's the water. Let's do it. Right? And what did Philip say? "If thou believest, thou mayest." He says, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." Stop. He got off. He did baptize. What happened? Come up rejoicing. Now, it's up to you in your Bible study, if you want something sort of strange, is find out when the angel of the Lord talked to Philip, where was he demographically? Where was he at in the picture? And when you see that, you figure out how he got from point A to where the eunuch is. I've read all sorts of things. Well, he either ran like Elijah, running from that crazy Jezebel, or something like, I don't know, man, or somebody says picked him up and put him over there. Maybe the angel of the Lord just got him as I just never heard that, never handled, you know. It's usually we just assume, you know, well, he went over. Okay, angel told him, so he just walked over. You look at the, you need that on your own. Yeah. Please tell us so we don't have to do all that work. Yeah. Tough. Well, needless to say, Philip obeyed the command, and we see that. And in Acts chapter 8, and you look at verse, 35. Then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him who? Jesus. So you see, these disciples knew the prophecies of the Old Testament. And when Jesus Christ showed up, you know when it says he came unto his own received him not? These received him. They knew that he was the Messiah, right? And so they were able to go to the Old Testament now, bringing that knowledge to it, to interpret it for this fellow to understand who it was talking about. And it was sort of easy. It was after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, so he already fulfilled all those things with the scourging and taking the transgressions upon him. I'm trying to, in verse 37 is the one NIV, RSV, and all those, somehow you won't find 37. And Philip said, "If thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest." And he answered and said, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." Okay, now removing that, Let's just read verse 36 and 38. And as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water, and the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized?" Verse 38. And he commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. So what's it missing? Salvation part. What do they say? See? Got to be baptized to be saved. See, it's wicked as hell. So people that use that, they wonder why we get mad. Oh, what you got is a garbage book. And we're just being nice with you. You know, trying to show you all the different things that are taken out. Why doesn't that offend people? I have no idea. Same thing with Daniel, right? Wasn't it in the fire? Wait, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Okay, fire. And they saw one member, instead of as the son of God, it was the son of the gods, plural. And that's not a big deal, these people. Hey, one of them verses, just one. There's nothing to throw in the garbage. Well, it's so easier to understand. No, you're lazy. If you read the King James Bible, the these and the thous make perfect sense. The only way you can translate properly, if you're talking about translation, is you have to use the these and the thous, because it includes singular and plural. It's just amazing, some of those. But anyway, King James Bible, word of God. Now, the last appearance in Acts is the last appearance in the New Testament. King Herod, after killing John, remember John's brother, James, go to Acts chapter 12. And verse 1 and 2. Now about that time, Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And we're going to read some of this. And because he saw it pleased the Jews. See, that's the key. Political leader, seeing who's pleasing who, right? Man, we're living in a day and age like that. He proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread. And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quaternions of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people. All right? Now, who's it talking about? Talking about Herod, talking about the heathen there. Verse 4 would not have Passover. They always say the Paschal lamb, Passover lamb. Should have been that, not Easter, because Easter's heathen. Well, the context is heathen. They don't do the Passover. Sorry, they do Easter. So in case you're wondering why Easter's there, that's why Easter's there. It's just the context. Well, you know, the word to translate, you're stupid. Herod's not going to say, let's celebrate the Passover. Are you nuts? He just killed James. He's going to try to kill Peter here. It's Easter, man. Simply put, it's Easter because of the context. Amen. And I'm going to come all the way down to, let's see here, because we're talking about angels. Mm-hmm. Verse 21 says, and upon a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat upon his throne and made an oration unto them. And the people gave a shout, saying, it is the voice of God, little g, and not of a man. I love verse 23. And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him, because he gave not glory to God. He gave not God the glory. And he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. That was some gross stuff. I mean, eating of worms. Inside out, I don't know, but it was some bad boy stuff. What happened? He met the angel of the Lord. Angel Lord can deliver that too. Man. And verse 24 I like, because after all this mess, but the word of God grew and what? Multiplied. And Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their ministry, and took with them John, whose surname was Mark. And we know what happened with John Mark. I hope you all do. Immature. Remember later on, and Paul got mad, and Barnabas, loving Barnabas, said, well, I'll take him. And so the Bibles will give you personalities, show you what people do right at the time, and then later on, when people are thinking, well, Barnabas was more loving and Saul was like, well, he's more mean and everything. He didn't have enough patience with him, right? But yet, later on, when Paul's ready to die, he says, bring Mark with thee. It's profitable unto me. Knowing that he grew in the Lord and was ready to be with Paul. And so you see certain things there. Personalities, personality traits, what God thinks. God protected both, right? It didn't take God by surprise that Barnabas was there with Saul when he was chosen, because they were in a local church, and they were chosen of God through the local church, and they were set out by the local church. Somebody said, well, you're worshiping the local church. Well, you're not going to find anything in this Bible where God was dealing in the New Testament that wasn't dealt through the local church. It's amazing that a lot of even King James Bible believers, we like our doctrine from Romans to Philemon, yet they don't read Romans to Philemon. You know, they're either saying, well, you're a legalist if you say this or that. I said, did you really read Paul? Did you really read Paul's epistles? Man, he lays more on us than anybody I know. I mean, you're talking about the Holy Spirit. You're talking about warfare, spiritual warfare. You're talking about chapter 7 of Romans, of the dual nature of man. And then he lists in, what is that, Galatians 5, the manifestations of the flesh. Paul did that, all of them. And then he says, and some. In other words, I didn't cover them all, and some. And then the last portion, he gives you 9 fruits of the Spirit. He says, okay, bud, that's what you're supposed to be doing, not these other ones. Well, how are you not going to do the other ones? Well, you're going to do it by letting the Lord work through you, giving you power not to do it. And if you don't, guess what you're going to succumb to? One of those deals. And that's the flesh, walking in the flesh. And so Apostle Paul deals with that heavy. Separation, you go into Corinthians, you find out about separation. There's a reason for that. And we don't need all the aggravation of being close to, so close to the world that we start to copy the world, and we start making judgments of what, how they teach us, and not the book. So by studying these angels, we're seeing, you know, an angel, we're seeing the angel of the Lord, and there's different cases where it have to be God, not just an angel. And eventually we'll get through this thing, and you'll see how it concludes. It was, I remember a long time ago, talking about emotion. Most of us are led by that anyway, even if we say we don't, either music-wise or stories or whatever. But I can remember going to the I keep wanting to say maybe it was a creation museum. We sat there and watched the solar system, and they taught us how this specific star, you know, only comes so, you know, so many years or whatever, and so it had to be the star that the wise shepherds knew about, studying the stars navigation wise and everything, that this was coming up, and it was supposed to foretell that there was going to be a king born, you know. And so they followed it. And then later on, I mean, I got goosebumps. I said, this is fantastic, because they connected it with that cross, you know, in the universe. There's a, I don't know, a solar system or something over there. There's a cluster, and there's like a cross. So just Google universe crossing stars or something. Anyway, I said, this is fantastic, man. And I started reading my Bible and started noticing how that star worked. Same women. Okay, it was over the shepherd. Went over here, zigzagged over here. I don't know any star constellation or anything that can move like that, you know. So, I believe it was an angel. And how do you do that? You connect it with angels are like stars. And they could have been reading Old Testament scripture where it talks about in Zechariah and that the Messiah was going to come. He was going to show up, you know, where he was. And saw that as an unusual thing in the sky and the way it moved. Because after all, I believe it moved slow enough that they could follow it. So anyway, if you study the thing out, you're going to find out that it is good that creation research went and did that. It's exciting, and it'll get some people maybe that were atheists to believe in whatever, but when you find out how the star moved, the direction it did and everything, I don't believe a real star is going to do that. God can make a real star do that, but I just believe it was a bright angel. Same one that announced his birth could brighten up the sky. And, hey, as far as we know, maybe he all of a sudden went this way. You know, I don't know. I'm saying that because when we're all done, you're not going to remember all this. See, I got handwritten things. If I can remember them 10 years from now, I'd be good. Where we studied all these verses thus far, and just about angels and how much power they have. We know they have no wings, absolutely no wings. Now, demons in heaven got wings, right? Cherubs have wings. Angels have no wings. And, well, you know, you saw Satan with wings. Well, he's a cherub, but he can also become an angel of light. And that means, therefore, no wings. He can surprise you. And also, the conclusion of this thing is going to show us a little bit, and you can probably swallow that it's a possibility, Daniel and Cutie, that we replaced the angels that fell. That's heresy. If you're a Bible believer and you go through all the angels, counts of angels, God Almighty, you believe the King James Bible is the Word of God, and you just trace the angels all the way through. Next thing you know, you're in Corinthians. Paul says, why are you judging these meager things? You're going to judge angels. You know, everybody says, oh, the church, cool, we're going to judge angels. Yeah. When's that going to happen? White throne judgment, correct? The Lord comes back. The Lord's coming back now, right? Remember the tribulation period, remember? This bad thing that's going to happen here. He comes in the clouds, meets us, his church, in the clouds. And then we got judgment seat of Christ. Another thing, what's he doing? Preparing the bride without spot or wrinkle. For what? The ceremony. We're espoused. And so here we are up in heaven. What's going on down here? Tribulation. Makes sense, right? We're the bride. We're not the Jewish nation. We're the bride of Christ. That includes Jews and anybody else that got saved. But they're no longer designated Jew or Gentile. They're called the church. Rapture happens. We go up. We go to judgment seat of Christ first. Get all cleaned up. Get ready for that marriage. Amen. All of a sudden, we're up there with the Lord. And Father looks at the Son. No, we don't. Why? Because that's what he does when he tells his Son to get the bride. That's us. So the Father ain't going to say that to his Son. But the Son, when the bride is prepared and everything, you know what he says? Mount up. And the only thing you got record of him coming back, he's coming back with his angel. See, that messes up everybody's head. Who's the angels? Is the church just staying up there when he's taking care of business? No. You go to Joel chapter 2, you start to see what's taking place. As he swoops down and does his thing, we're behind him. Yeah, but nobody teaches that preacher. Well, why don't you read your Bible? What does the Bible tell you? You are mounting up, and you are classified as angels. Now, they may take all that out of the King James and all this stuff and claim Hebrew, Greek, or Sanskrit or something. Not I. So we come back to the Lord. Are we a step up from other angels? Yeah. Why? We tasted grace. But we also got in by what? Free will. The ones that got out up yonder with the devil had free will. How do I know? Because they chose the devil and not our God. What happened to all them? They're in chains. Most of them are in chains. Others are out doing what? Antifa or whatever they do. See, if you preach this on radio or whatever, they will lambast you and say, man, all I'm saying is get your Bible. The way we do it around here since I've been here, the only time I ever went to Greek or Hebrew was from school, and that was just to correct other people's manuscripts, and I'm about through with that stuff. We got the book, and so I tell you, you go and get a Strong's Concordance. You do not I don't care about the Greek or the Hebrew. It's messed up anyway. They use, you know, the other manuscripts, the Sinaiticus, Vaticanus, and Alexandrinus, mixed in with some Textus Receptus. You don't need that aggravation. But anyway, so you look at this stuff, and you say angel, and you go to Genesis, and you just start working your way to Revelation. And basically, that's what we're doing, Nick. We're just showing you every place that it's mentioned, the verses with it. And you can come to some great conclusions that way. Get around Job. You find out them angels be singing up there, them stars. And how is that possible? Well, there was a guy named Lucifer that didn't fall yet. He was the choir director. That's why everybody tells you, watch out about the music you listen to. If it's emotionally driven all the time, you got, and I'm telling you, well, it's got a few good lyrics to it. If it's emotionally driven, and you're emotionally driven, and he's not elevated where he's supposed to be, you can have a problem with stuff like that. The devil knows this. Who's that philosopher? Starts with a P. I almost said Pluto. Plato. He says, give me the music of the world, and I will control the world. That was way back with him. How about that? He is crazy as a bedbug on a lot of things. But Aristotle, these guys that were thinkers, they visually seen things and got human wisdom. Everybody thinks they were so bold. And well, they had Proverbs, and people don't understand that. They also read Proverbs. I'm telling you, if they read everything, they get their hands on the whole Library of Alexandria. But they knew that the scriptures were there, and that's what the Jews followed. And they knew about prophets preaching. You got to go back to the years where they were at. You got to see where the nation of Israel was at the time. These were all discussed among the philosophers, so they had a lot of insight into that, just like Nostromedon. You know, everybody praises him. Man, he had the Old Testament, old Jew. And when he put out prophecies, if you looked, a lot of them are comparable to Isaiah and other places like that that said what's going to happen down the line. And they praise him, but they don't want to do an Isaiah study or nothing, you know. That's just man, intellectually. So I said all that to say this, that if you do a study on angels yourself, and you put down, you know, their power, their sex, male, no wings, that eliminates a whole lot of things that people have misconceptions about, make Christmas cards and everything else about. That is not angels, right? And then you see how they communicate with man, as we saw, throughout scriptures, I mean, actual communication. Paul says, though I speak with tongues of angels, now that could be an angelic language that the tongue speakers try to take, but I more or less think it's the ability to whoever they talk to for those people to understand the language that they're speaking in. Because all through the scriptures, if an angel says, hey, bud, you turn around and say, okay, I don't care what it is, Hebrew, Sanskrit, or whatever, whatever he says to those people, they understand. That's the gift of tongues. Book of Acts, every nation under heaven, it says, was represented. And they spoke clearly the language of those people and presented the gospel to those people. And they were unlearned. They were fishermen. And so languages, not babbling, is associated with God. And but there again, somebody would have to take time to read all the verses, and they don't. They have pet verses. That's why I told you, if there's a verse, I teach that if there's a verse in this Bible that makes perfect sense, I'm telling you, you can go to any of the perversions that are out there, and more than likely, it's out of their Bible. Anything that has to do with just faith, Colossians 1:14, you get into the blood, go into the blood verse and see how many they took out. You know what the explanation was? Well, he already said blood over here, that's good enough. No, it's the context. So they've destroyed all that, and what have they created? A progressive, identity-driven church. You know the society that we have now? Progressive identity system. You know who's going to finally come together? Yeah. Under who? The false prophet. You see that already. People argue with you. You King James Bible people are so mean and everything like this. Yeah, they want a kissy face, and the people that kiss face, kill them. Beat them up. Take everything. And they whine. I don't know about you, but I'm just disgusted, just even at the manhood of somebody kneeling down and kissing people's feet and stuff. I'm saying, what? What? All that fear? If you're not confident that you know God, if you're not confident that if you die you're going to heaven, that presents a lot of paranoid situations. Because now it's like survival mode, and these kids through three generations have not been taught that. They've been hippified. Men have been feminized. You know, not all, but most. And we're seeing that on television. If you understood as a Christian that God has angels protecting you, that God can change your whole situation, that God can protect you from a car wreck or anything like this, when you understand that power that you really have, and then you start going over to Matthew and you start looking at what the Lord says about kids. What do you mean about kids? We're his kids. You mess with his kids. Most Christians are praying, not Lord, don't kill them, because God's got every right to kill anybody that's messing with us. And we forget that that is the power. And he can generate that power. So for those that mess with us that are lost, our prayer ought to be, Lord, be merciful to them. Give them time. You know, peradventure they can exercise their will to receive you. And we're not going to do that because we don't believe that. We don't believe that that's God up there, our Father, that can do that. But he can. And when you look over your whole life, you're going to find out certain situations that you were in, maybe people that hated your guts, all of a sudden they got fired. And you were rejoicing. Oh, man, I didn't know that. See that coming. That was cool. And you never stop to think they got fired because they messed with you. Neighbors all of a sudden move. You know, you're not praising God for it. You're just saying, man, that's good. I'm sure glad they are because I would have had to move. Boom, they move. And Christians are so far out of their element that they don't believe that God moved them out to get somebody in there that they can witness to and get saved, too. They just ain't thinking. So when we're studying these angels, what I'm saying is even in prison, you know, you and I can't recognize them unless they reveal themselves to us. That's why you may entertain angels unaware. Now that's basically to the Jew, you know, during their time, God has always protected them like that. I mean, seeing, believing, we don't operate by sight. And that's why it's harder. It is harder. So therefore, we don't operate by sight, yet our body demands sight. So we don't notice things spiritually. That's why you have to read your Bible every day, and you really got to communicate with God every day. Somehow you got to talk to him, whether it's asking forgiveness for all the junk you're doing or something. You got to have a communication. And by doing that, you become sensitive to the Spirit. And then you're soul conscious, but you're also conscious of everything that's going around you and what God's doing for you and what God's doing, period. And you believe God. So doing these angels have helped me a lot to understand the angel from a biblical point of view, but also it's shown me the angel of the Lord and it's shown me the power that he can demonstrate. When Joshua, I'm just going through your mind now because you should have read at least some or heard something about Joshua. If you remember, when he was coming in the land there, somebody stopped him, one person. And he fell on his face. And that was the captain of the host. And that was the Lord Jesus Christ. See, Jesus Christ was a body. Just wasn't incarnate in our flesh yet. And you will see those appearances in the Bible in the Old Testament. And so he represented that. He said he was the captain of the Lord, the host, captain of your salvation. And Joshua knelt down and listened, and he led the way. We know that there's an angel that we just covered 2 weeks ago. I forgot what it was, 180,000? Slew one angel. I don't think he broke the sweat. And he left the corpses lie there. That's a lot. so we have all these people messing with us. If God wanted to, one angel. We look and say, well, how did it get wicked all of a sudden? Wickedness in high places, man. People in the second heaven. And fallen angels, they're operating down here. We always talk about holding strings, puppets, you know, Searles and everything. Oh, there's somebody that has him. Prince and power of the air. We're fighting principalities. I'm giving you all sorts of doctrine now. Because I ran out of notes. So what else, preacher? Well, let me think. Well, those people that are up there are called principalities and dominions. So dominions has what? Kings. A dominion has a king. It's a kingdom. So how many kingdoms are in the second heaven? I mean, all we see is stars. Oh, many. Many. Is Jesus on his throne yet, George? No. He's sitting next to God the Father. Where's God the Father? On his throne. Well, where's Jesus going to get a throne? On planet Earth, in Jerusalem. It's called the throne of his glory. So when he hops on his horse, and we're behind him, and we're coming through the second heaven, God the Father is collecting all the crowns from all those kings of all them dominions. You know what he does? He puts them on Jesus' head. Why? He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he comes down with us, sets up that kingdom for 1,000 years. No more dominions up there. What happened to him? Put in hell. Man. Yeah. It's in your Bible. It's in your Bible. Amen. Okay. Let me pray. Father God, we love and appreciate you.